I'm Lisa A. Smith, plant-based health and business coach. You moderated yourself to a diagnosis.
My.
Our genes load the gun, but our diet and lifestyle pulls the trigger. You can't moderate yourself to healing. You can engage publicly without anybody knowing you feeding your addiction.
What gives you the right to tell me and teach me this?
I am evidence of what I do.
That's an addiction.
Yeah. I was talking to an addict. I was just hearing an addict talk.
You're going to be an addict. I'm just stuck on the, I'm an addict. Yo, I'm done. That's the leg lady right there.
So I'm Lisa Smith, plant-based health and business coach. I specialize in helping people combat chronic health challenges with a plant-based diet, and also specialize in business coaching and helping people develop profitable health coaching businesses. And you can find me at lisaangelsmith.com or on social media at Lisa Angel Smith on YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook.
Here's one of my premier questions that I don't get to ask a lot because I'm not talking to disciplined people or people who operate at a very high level. So I'm sure you can stomach this. If this is what you do, what gives you the right to tell me and teach me this?
Mm-hmm. So I am evidence of what I do. So first of all, I've had over a 60 plus pound weight loss myself. Adopting a whole food plant-based lifestyle has by far been the most powerful and most successful thing I've done in my health, both from the neck down and the neck up. So I have mental clarity as a result of my diet. I have high creativity, high recall, high concentration as a result of my plant-based lifestyle. And it was so powerful for me that I decided to start helping other people. So I've been in business, it'll be 10 years next year, that I've been helping individuals combat health challenges by making lifestyle modifications. It has been the absolute most rewarding part of my life and my career, and I am living in my purpose. I was not called to do anything that what I'm called to do right now, to speak, to teach, and to educate people on how to live radically obedient by starting with their health. So I started with myself, and I have about a decade of receipts.
And I, let me say this to you, though. I am shocked about muscle.
Mm-hmm.
Because I assume when I start lifting and I start running, that I would be like 20 pounds. I thought I would see it on the scale in a different way.
Oh.
Let me say that. Mm-hmm. I didn't know, because I was like discouraged a little bit. But then I was like, okay, well, I can fit my large shirts.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't fit them. So how am I fitting them? But the scale says,
and
it's like, I mean, I know what they say about 30 pounds of fat look like this and 30
yep.
pounds of muscle, but the reality of it is like, whoa, I just assume if I could fit this shirt again, it would mean I would have to lose
X amount
of weight, but I guess I was losing X amount of fat.
Yep, and inches. Yeah. Body composition changes. And you can't, even though you can control where you build muscle, you can't control where you lose fat. Yeah. So you can work a certain muscle group. Like I want biceps, I want quads. But fat loss, you don't get to dictate where it comes from.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'll say that one more time.
You don't get to dictate where fat comes from, even though you can manipulate where you put muscle on. So when you're trying to lose, you might like, I really want this gut to go down, but your legs slim down first.
Yeah.
Can't do nothing about that.
Okay.
That's the most frustrating thing when you're trying to lose. It's like, no, I want to see this go away.
Yeah.
But it's like, no, you can't. Man. You can't spot reduce, but you can control what you build.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
So I should have heard that earlier before I let the fat accumulate.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
100%.
Yeah. Because once the fat got there, it was like, oh, no, homie.
Yeah. Yep.
We running this show now.
100%.
Yeah.
But then also what you're dealing with stress with the company last year.
Yeah.
The highest amount of our stress receptors are in our gut.
Mm.
So when you see somebody who legs and arms are leaner, but they carry most of their weight in the midsection, that can be indicative of high stress.
Wow.
Everything is not diet.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so I got to tell C when he joking, it was
got to stop stressing
you out. It was stress, bro.
That's it.
He was stressing me out.
100%.
Yeah, no question.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's dope.
Yeah.
I did want to say this too, because this is funny. This has nothing to do with diet, y'all. This has everything to do with timing.
Mm-hmm.
So I laugh having you here today and then knowing you in the mastermind because Carl knew you first.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it's weird, like, oh, Lisa had been around. So I didn't know who you were,
mm-hmm.
other than the Lisa who Carl would always talk about. with the leg boy. So like he would be coming to me all the time talking to me about legs.
Work them legs.
Like Lisa said, and I'm like, who is Lisa? And why is she influencing our legs? Like, I don't even know who
not
she
us,
is.
Our legs.
Yeah, our legs. Like, because that's all Carl would talk about. It's like, E, you got to do squats. You got to do this. Like, if you want your brain and you want to be able to, you got to do these legs. And I was like, okay, Carl, I don't know who she is and why she's so influential in the leg industry. Like, I don't know. So then I saw you. It's correct. Uh-huh. And Carl was like, there she, that's her. And I was like, oh, okay. Still didn't know who you were, but I was like, okay, that's the leg lady right there. And at that time, you weren't really set, like, not that you weren't saying a lot, but in public, you were kind of introvert,
yes,
extrovert.
100%.
You know what I'm saying? And so then when we would have the extreme execution thing, I was like, guards down, that's the leg lady. At whatever point we get to talk, we'll talk. And then when you got in the mastermind, of course, we were talking regularly. And so now I'm like, oh, I personally know the leg lady. You know what I'm saying? I know the leg lady now. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know her for something other than legs. I know her for sugar now. I know her for me feeling the need to tell her I'm not eating this or I'm not eating that. And also for now I know what people mean when they say you were in my brain. Mm. I didn't really, when they would say that about me, I didn't know what they were talking about. So I know for me, one of the things that as I hit my 50s, mm-hmm. you know, the doctors start really going heavy on history. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't remember them asking me when I was 20-something, mm-hmm. like, what was your father's, mm-hmm. or what was your mother? Matter of fact, the reason why I know is because my biological father wasn't in my life. Mm-hmm. So it would have triggered something if they would have asked me about my biological father. So that's how I know they never said anything to me. So I know once I hit like 40, 50, mm-hmm. they start asking me questions like, you know, what do you know about your father's, you know, history? Like, I guess they assume he was in my life. So it was like, what do you know about this? And your grandfather, like, did he whatever? And I'm like, I don't know. Mm-hmm. So for me, I have been taught that all of my challenges as it relates to disease or whatever is family.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Like, is my daddy's fault? Is nothing I can do about it? Is my mama's fault? It's the combination of them coming together. It's their fault.
Yes.
What do you say to a person who's trying to make changes, but it's like, oh, I can't make them anyway because I'm doomed to the genetic history of my family?
For the overwhelming majority of people, what they don't understand is that your genetics play less than a 10% role in your health outcomes.
Wow.
So while we're told by healthcare providers and people we trust, and even our family members, this runs in our family, the truth of the matter is lifestyle disease, hypertension, high cholesterol, obesity, type 2 diabetes, kidney failure, autoimmune disease can only be combated with lifestyle. Now, we can manage it with medication, but if you want to eradicate it so that it's no longer an issue for you, you have to overhaul your entire lifestyle. And so while genetics plays a role, it doesn't play the biggest role. So what I like to say is that our genes load the gun, but our diet and lifestyle pulls the trigger.
Mm. Okay. So then it's not just the genetics. It's also I'm eating what my grandma ate.
So it's not just the genetics. We're eating what our grandparents and great-grandparents ate. And so what we really pass down, what really runs in our family is the recipe for the mac and cheese. Mm. What really runs in our family is the recipe for the pound cake.
Mm.
So if we really wanted to stop and change the health outcomes for ourselves and the babies coming behind us, what we want to do is change what we eat, change how we move, change our relationship with stress, change our relationships with fulfillment, not just working to pay bills, but truly working for self-actualization, making sure we understand that the number one indicator of longevity and life expectancy is actually our relationships and our social connections, even above diet and exercise. And so health is not just a matter of our DNA. It's just not just a matter of how we move. It's not just a matter of how we eat, but our health is a composition of our entire lifestyle choices. And so if we want to combat these conditions and get them under control, is super important that we don't just look at our DNA, not just our family history, but literally the choices we make every single day. In most cases, lifestyle disease is a choice.
Man, so let's talk. I want to pick a couple of those out. So let's go with stress first, because I think a large majority of people in our communities are stressed out. And I didn't even know what stress was. Like, I was coming up, I didn't even realize my grandma was stressed, you know, with 14 kids, you know, living in the Herman Gardens. You know, like, I didn't even know she was stressed with all her kids coming over to her house to babysit us. And she had to cook, because I don't remember most of us going with a sack lunch. Like, so she got to cook. So it was so normal that we didn't even see it. How does this stress thing you're talking about, how does that support a healthy lifestyle?
So stress is arguably one of the top causes of chronic disease for our culture, period. Most people don't even recognize when they're chronically stressed, right? Chronic stress is recognizable from a biological standpoint with elevated levels of cortisol. Most people, because we understand stress and stressful things are a part of life, we don't understand the difference between acute and chronic. So acute stress is temporary. There's an end in sight. We know, like, once this flat tire is fixed, once this project at work is over, you know, once this horrible legal issue is over, it's over and we can continue with business as usual. But most people are living in a state of chronic stress, meaning it's 3 months or longer. There's no end in sight. And it's something that's constantly causing us overwhelm, angst, anxiety, maybe even depressive mood. And stress, what it does is it sends a signal to our brain. When we have elevated levels of cortisol, it sends a signal to our brain that we are in danger. When our body and our brain believes we are in danger, it pushes blood out toward our limbs so that we can physically run. So it restricts blood flow to the center of our body, which means we now have compromised gut health, our digestive system, and all the other biological functions that our body does are compromised because our body is only concerned with giving us back to safety. It doesn't recognize that we're just driving down the street or laying in bed at night and we're just thinking about the thing that's overwhelming us. Our body is like, yo, this cortisol is hitting me. We must need to get out of danger. And so what happens if you go multiple months and years with these elevated stress hormones, our body is not able to do all the functions it needs to do to keep us whole and healthy. Stress is a silent killer. And if you are chronically stressed, I need you to stop listening to the rhetoric that's telling us to manage stress. Your goal should be to eliminate chronic stress, not manage it.
Wow. So you're saying I can run, I can walk, I can drink water, you know, I can get in a sauna, but if I'm stressed, like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
you ain't did much.
Man, that's crazy.
You're not dealing with the bigger issue. If you're working a job that you can't stand 40 hours a week, if you're staying in a relationship that's not mutually beneficial, if you're not talking to family and friends, if you're, you know, financial stress, if you're in spiritual warfare, like, it could be in any area of your life. The thing you want to prioritize is combating the chronic stressor. As long as you're chronically stressed, everything you do behind it is going to be dulled.
Wow. That's crazy. That's crazy. Okay. All right. So let's go with another one. So we're prioritizing, we're stress first. What was the name of the stress again?
Chronic stress.
The chronic one. What was the other one called?
Acute stress.
So the chronic one, we got to eliminate that completely.
And it's possible.
Wherever we see it.
Yes.
Okay. So that's another one. How is it possible?
Yeah, it's possible. So I remember, Eve, me and you, we had, I'm in the mastermind, and I remember we were in Atlanta one weekend, and we were going up Stone Mountain, and I asked you a very specific question, because I was worried about it. I'm like, is this possible? And I asked you, is it okay for everything in your life to be okay? Or should we always be battling something, fixing something? Because I was in a place where I felt everything was good, but I wanted to make sure I didn't have any blind spots. And you told me it was, and you gave me permission to let everything be okay. And so what I want people to understand is that one of the most common things we say in our culture is it's always something. It's not true. It don't always have to be something. So the very first way you start to combat chronic stress is you switch your belief that something's always got to be wrong. You have to give yourself permission to let everything be okay. Sometimes when we have a limiting belief like there's always something, we search in our ecosystem for evidence of the limiting belief that we just made up. So first you have to believe that it's truly possible for your finances, your relationship, your health, your career, your spirituality to be at a place that where you've done the work and you're at a place where you can just live in the work that you've done and live off the fruits of your labor, of doing the personal development work, of having the discipline, of doing the work. And so that's what I had to believe first and foremost, that it is possible to live a life where I'm not dealing with anything that's stressing me out. Now, once you've understood that and you've switched that belief and now you're on a roll to get from up under this chronic stress, you need two things. You need an exit strategy and you need an enter strategy. One of the biggest mistakes people make when it's time to combat some challenge they're having in their life is they only formulate an exit strategy. How I'm gonna quit this job, how I'm gonna get out of this relationship, right? But what they don't typically have is an enter strategy. So if you're dealing with a health challenge right now, you know, you wanna exit from the blood pressure medication, from the insulin, right? You wanna exit from the excess weight. However, the version of you that's exiting from that may not know how to survive in the thing you're trying to enter into, which is optimal health.
That's good.
The version of you that's exiting from debt may not know how to survive what you're trying to enter into, which is financial freedom. So don't make the mistake of thinking exiting from one situation automatically means you're in the situation you want to be into. Exiting from a 9-to-5 doesn't mean you know you are who you need to be to survive in entrepreneurship. So I need you to create two strategies. Exiting from the thing you don't want to exist in anymore. And you need an enter strategy for who do I need to become to be a successful entrepreneur? Who do I need to become to be a person who's not overweight? I only know how to be in a body that's overweight and that I'm insecure in and that I have to put medications in. So how do I enter into the circumstance that I want to be in and exit from the undesirable circumstance? So chronic stress, eliminating it requires a shift in belief system that it's possible not to be stressed out about something. And two, an exit strategy from the undesirable and an enter strategy into the desirable.
Yeah, that's good. So I'm just saying what I'm hearing. When we say it's always something, that's acute. Meaning that that may happen. My tire might blow.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like that could happen.
100%.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? But when we say it, we are saying it as if it's, what's the other one?
Chronic.
So we're saying it as it's chronic.
Yep. Something always got to be wrong
right.
in my life.
So now we just on, no, I'm not chronic. No. No. But mm-hmm. acute, yes, that's going to happen.
Yes.
There's going to rain or snow.
Absolutely.
It's going to be ice in the D.
Absolutely.
And I'm just like, wow, I think that definition alone can stop everything. It doesn't have to be this. I can control this.
Yes.
This one. It's out of my control, and that one can happen, but that one has a shorter time frame on it. So I don't even have to take it as serious because the tire is going, you know. And so for those of you listening, I'm just giving you an example. I have an opportunity to do something in Detroit for the draft, working with a group of kids, and it was on the 25th of April. And I had another gig that Brandon was working on. Brandon called me and said, it's on the 25th of April. Mm. And I was like, no, B, say that one more time. I just want to make sure I'm hearing you. He said, oh, I didn't know you had the pay gig in Cali on the 25th. So I told him you could do this event on the 25th. So I was like, oh, okay. The old me would have, I'm optimistic, but the old me would have been like worried a little. But we're going to work it out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the new me is like, oh, no, it's already worked out.
Yeah.
And it's worked out because I'm the speaker. So it's already worked out. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is not a challenge because I get to decide where I want to be and what I want to do.
That's right.
So I called Brandon. I was like, yo, B, do me a favor. Isn't there an event multiple days? He was like, yeah. I said, okay, well, call them and tell them I need to change the date. So he called me back. Was like, man, E, they said they can't do it. They put all the marketing stuff out in the calendar. I said, it's not possible. It's March. Like, it's not possible that you can't do it. It's March. I'm speaking in April. So my whole disposition was everything is okay. Everything is great.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, B, here's what I want you to do. Give me the number. I'll take the number.
Yeah.
Because maybe when you call, you gave them an option.
Mm-hmm.
Even though you told them, but you can't. So I got on the phone and they were like, no, we can't. We already sent out the, and I said, okay, well, I have an opportunity during the NFL draft to speak to a group of kids from Detroit, where I'm from, and I want to be able to. And so they were like, oh, you have a get, oh, okay. So we did do this, but can you give me 24 hours? I was like, ah, why, of course I can give you 24 hours. They called me back. We switched it. You're on Monday. You're on Tuesday. I said, thank you.
Yeah.
For not cocky or arrogant, but thank you for manifesting what I already knew, is that I don't have to sacrifice this group for this group.
Yeah.
But there would have been a time, and I want those of you who are listening to hear me, there would have been a time that it would have worked out, but I would have put a down payment of stress on something that wasn't necessary. Mm. So some of us, we do get what we manifest.
100%.
But we put a down payment
100%.
On the stress, boy, because Job said, the thing that I feared has come upon me.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, okay, Job, then you was thinking about this. You was stressed out about this. You was worried about it. So the thing that you thought was going to happen, you brought into. So even though you were blessed, you still put a down payment.
Yes.
On, and so I just want those people who are like us, who are doing well in life, you know, who got it going on, but put a down payment on stress. I just want you to stop putting a down payment on
stress.
Please
and thank you.
Yeah.
Everything is perception.
Yeah.
And as long as you live by everything always works out for me, you ain't got to worry about it.
Yeah.
You ain't got to worry about it. So doing exactly what you did, change your belief. And when situations like that come up, they're going to be acute. I talk to you in 24 hours with a solution.
Yeah.
It's that simple.
That's it. All right. So Lisa, I hit you with a picture once when I was in, I guess it was TJ Maxx, and they got, you know, I don't know. Well, I do know why they do it, but it's like Pop don't have nothing to do with TJ Maxx. It's supposed to be retail.
Yeah.
But every time I go into TJ Maxx and I get in the line, it's a bunch of stuff on the way that I'm not supposed to be eating. And then they got the Pop Boy. And for those of you who are not from the Midwest, I'm using the term pop. It's soda, just in case you don't know what I'm saying when I say that. So they got pop, soda, and at first it used to be Coke, right? And so then my daughter sent me a video of a battery corroded and they poured the Coke on it and it cleansed that boy.
Yep.
And so she was kind of like, and so I was like, oh, I get it. I'll go to Orange Pop. You know what I'm saying?
For sure.
You can't pour that on there and get that. So then she was like, you drinking orange? It's dying orange. So I was like, all right, Sprite it is. We good now. We just go to Sprite.
Clear.
And yes. You know what I'm saying? Like, it don't have no dye in it. Now we got, you know, then I'm going to do ginger ale because, hey, it's ginger in that joke. Like, and I know ginger roots have to be good for you, right? So we were talking.
Yes.
And I was telling you about it, you know, and one of, you know, my health tricks culturally, and I'm gonna be real. I've heard this in the church more than I've heard it anywhere. Like I heard it in the church probably first and forever. But it was like, yo, the Coke is cool, or the Orange Pop is cool, and the Sprite is, the ginger ale is definitely good in moderation.
Yes.
Yeah, in moderation. Yeah.
All right, you triggering me, Issa. Let me try and relax, okay?
Okay.
Okay, this is usually the point where I jump on my seat, but
right.
I'm going to calm down and say it slow, right? We're going to start off civilized. Okay, so here's what people tend to believe, right? I can eat a little bit of the stuff that's not good for me, as long as maybe I balance it out with some stuff that's good for me, or as long as I reduce it. Here's the challenge. If you're battling something, hypertension, high cholesterol, obesity, cancer, diabetes, whatever it is, you moderated yourself to that disease.
I felt Carl in the back. I felt Carl in the back on that one. I felt him breathing on my neck on that one. Run that back.
Yeah.
Encore.
Let's be very clear.
Yeah.
It wasn't one meal that did that.
Mm.
It wasn't two. Mm. It wasn't 1 year. You moderated yourself to the disease. You did the exact same thing. You had a little bit today, a little bit tomorrow. Maybe you felt guilty, did a week clean, had a little more. You moderated yourself to a diagnosis.
Like that, the week clean, because that's me.
Yeah, okay.
I cleanse for a week.
I know how y'all do. Oh, yeah, top of the year.
Yeah.
Don't let the first fall on a Monday. Oh, it's full speed ahead, right? So you moderated yourself to a diagnosis.
My.
Tell me, what sense does it make to make you think you can microdose the toxins that got you the disease and reverse it? They can't coexist. You got to choose. Here's the other thing. Part of the reason most people have adopted an everything in moderation mindset, it's because they have an addiction. Okay. And so when you were sharing, E, okay, if I can't do the Coke, I'll do the orange. If I can't do the orange, I'll do the Sprite. If I can't do the Sprite, I'll do the ginger ale. I was talking to an addict. I was just hearing an addict talk. That's all it was, right? That was addict language, right? Mm. I'm going to find a way to get my fix because you're not in love with pop. You're in love with sugar. Mm. Pop is your vehicle. Somebody else got the same addiction. Cookies is their vehicle. Mm. Somebody else got the same addiction. Candy bars is their vehicle. So you're addicted to a substance, and what you're trying to do is find good news about your bad habits. Mm. You said this one ain't got no dye in it. Right? Tell me some good news about my bad habit. Yeah, yeah. Right?
My.
Okay, so that's nothing but addict language. So moderation is a problem for two main reasons. Number one, you can't moderate yourself to healing if you moderated yourself to the diagnosis. You can't use the same system. Doesn't make any sense. But the bigger reason everything in moderation doesn't make sense is because moderation is a privilege, not a right. Meaning if you're in the middle of treating something, you don't get the privilege of eating smaller doses of the stuff that got you there. But moderation implies self-control. The number one definition of addiction is I have a loss of self-control. So if you are addicted to something, you have a loss of self-control around the substance, around the behavior, around the opportunity to do the thing. Moderation implies I'm going to practice self-control. I need y'all to stop being honest with yourself. Number one, if you're not at optimal health, if you're trying to lose weight, if you're trying to put something in remission, if you're trying to get off of medication, maybe you don't have a diagnosis, but you know you're not optimal. Those headaches every day, that constipation, the joint pain, whatever it is, if you're not optimal, you don't get the privilege of moderation. Moderation is reserved for those of us who have done the work to get to our bodies and brains to a place of optimization.
Carl, you want it?
But it says zero sugar.
Because the food companies know what you need to hear and read in order to make yourself feel good about your bad habits. Zero sugars means we have sweetened this with sugar alcohols that technically by the FDA, we don't have to list as sugar. Mm. It's still going to be sweet and it's still toxic substances in the product. So zero sugar just means we use sugar alcohols. We found a loophole. That's what that means.
Yeah, Carl, it's not that I don't know the next question to ask. I'm just stuck on the, I'm an addict. You know what I'm saying? I never saw myself. I'm like, yo, you a fiend.
Yeah. You a fiend. As you said, no, Coke, I can have orange. Yeah, no, yeah. I can have Sprite. Yeah. I can have, I said, oh, this is an addict talking.
And I'm not knowing. So what do we do to get out of the addict? Like Ray Charles went cold turkey.
Yeah.
You know, what do we do for those of us who just realized, man, I'm a Christian addict.
Oh, yeah, 100%. You need to embody Ray. Embody the spirit of Ray. The only way to get over an addiction is abstinence. The only way. In any other substance situation, we tell them, you can't have it. You can't have access to it. It's abstinence. The issue with food is that we have to eat to live. And because eating is socially acceptable, unlike shooting heroin, first of all, you can engage publicly without anybody knowing you feeding your addiction. We're both having a dessert. I'm good for 6 months. You only good for 6 hours. Nobody knows you're an addict. So because eating is socially acceptable, some people don't even believe you can be addicted to food. Like, we got to eat. You're right. But you don't have to eat fake stuff that was created by man with all of the added sugar, the food dyes, the preservatives, the MSG. That's all of the stuff that's disease promoting, that's causing disease in our body. And food companies have something. They have scientists that they spend millions and millions of dollars on to create what's called a bliss point. The bliss point is when they find that very, very perfect spot that gets your palate addicted to the substance, right? And that's where you can't eat just one comes from. We found the bliss point in the formula for this product that we're going to ensure you're going to come back for more.
Snickers.
We're going to, bliss point.
The bliss Snicker point. Bar. I've been set up, Carl. I've been run amok. I've been bamboozled. I've been running. Oh, man.
They found your bliss point. Led astray. They found your bliss point.
They knew I had one.
100%.
And they got me going back.
Oh, and you fell hard.
Oh, no. I got to tell the truth because I ain't had a Snicker bar forever. Cheeto Puffs.
Bliss
That's
point.
That's it. That's the bliss.
Yes.
And it ain't nothing. I see the toxic on my fingers, girl.
It leaves a residue.
It won't even come off, girl.
It leaves a residue.
It won't even come off, girl. I got to go home and take a bath. And but yeah, and it's so funny because you talked about the bliss point. What's so funny is I literally have said to myself, yo, I'm done. Mm. And I was done. Mm. But the bliss point wasn't done. And I'm saying this to y'all. Y'all got to hear what I'm saying. I haven't even had a bag of Cheetos, but I know it's a bliss point because every time I go in the store, I feel bad about not getting them. It's like Cheetos be like they talking to me like, E, bruh, you just going to walk past us? Mm-hmm. So what I'm telling you is that even though I haven't opened the bag, it's still something chemically connected to me and the Cheetos in the way that Lay's potato chips, I'm not looking at some plain Lay's and going, I got to have them. I'm not looking at Doritos.
Yep.
But something happened when I hit that Cheeto puff. That scientist knew my structure. And ever since I've had them, and like, okay, so it's so funny. The last, here's how I, yeah, it's a battle, Carl. It's a battle. I literally was in Cali, and I was like, I got to get some Cheeto puffs. And everywhere I would go, Carl, they had a big bag. And I was like, I'm not, I can't eat a big bag because I know I'm an addict. So I didn't get them because they had the big bag, Carl. I was like, but if I find a small bag, and I literally went to three stores and none of them had it. Nobody had the smaller ones.
Yeah.
I was like, I'm not opening up a big one because I know if I open up the big one, I'm about to be back. But I went to three stores.
Looking for that.
So even though I didn't get them, This bliss thing is so important because it made me drive to three different stores looking for the dime bag. I tell you, that's...
Wow. Three signs you are addict.
Yeah, that's it.
You just called it out, so I'm going to call it out.
Thank you.
If you're listening to this and you want to know, do you have an issue? If you're still trying to tell yourself you good, okay, let's give you three tangible signs. I'm going to give you biological, behavioral, and emotional really quick. Biological sign of addiction. Biological sign of addiction is what happens when I stop eating it. We call that what? Detox and withdrawals. Okay. So what E was just expressing is withdrawals. I'm going to three stores. I need a hit. Right? That's withdrawals, right? Detox, you guys probably experience, especially when you try and give up sugar, headaches, moodiness, your skin might break out. So you have a physical, a biochemical, a physiological response to stop taking the substance. It happens with caffeine. It happens with sugar. It happens with fatty foods, right? So detox and withdrawal is a biological sign of addiction. Okay. A behavioral sign of addiction is what I mentioned earlier, which is a loss of self-control. A loss of self-control despite the negative consequences. I know when I eat this, my stomach gonna hurt. I know when I eat this, the scale gonna move. I know when I have this, I'm gonna break out. For me, sugar, I knew my back was gonna be inflamed after I had a donut every time. I still had the donut. So a loss of self-control despite understanding the negative consequences. That's behavioral addiction. And finally, the third sign is gonna be emotional. When I do have it, and I know I'm in a season where I'm supposed to be staying away from it, guilt and shame, okay? So the guilt and the shame. And so guilt and shame usually shows up as I'm trying to hide it. It's private, typically, right? I don't want people to know. Or maybe I've told people about my health goals, but I keep running back to the fried chicken, to the French fries, to the junk food. I'm in the drive-thrus. I've had clients who like hid cookies in the trash can and went and got them out and ate them anyway. Like addicts, it's crazy. So signs of addiction is number one, what happens when you stop having it? Detox and withdrawal. Yep, I had a dependency on that. Because what happened last time you gave up KOE? When you ain't had spinach. Any.
I don't remember. I'm trying to remember.
Exactly.
I don't even know if I remember what happened when I gave up.
Exactly. Yeah. If you ain't had a Brussels sprout around, I can almost guarantee you ain't having no detox or withdrawal.
Here's what I do know, though. I've never ate kale in the car before I went in the house.
100%. 100%.
You ain't never secretly
being some kale before everybody could see.
Yeah, you're right.
And knock the kale dust off.
No, I promise you I haven't. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so that's important, right? So detox and withdrawals, a loss of self-control despite knowing the negative consequences and outcomes and the guilt and shame that comes along with the behavior. Those are signs that we have a dependency on something.
Okay, so give us some hope. And I know some because I've been dealing with you.
Yeah.
But give the audience, you got three things you mentioned. Which one of them is the easiest to come off? Maybe none is easier, but maybe a couple strategies that we can use?
Yeah, first thing we need to do is get the self-control. And so that's going to be understanding that what people say that kind of trips them up psychologically, the language people use when they need to stay away from the fried chicken, need to stay away from the Cheetos, need to stay away from the sugar, the language they use is, I can't have that. I want you to switch your language to, I don't want that. Because I can't have that. You psychologically is going to, you're going to want it 10 times more. I don't like being denied. And people say, I can't have that, feels like deprivation. So in order for us to practice the abstinence that's required to combat addiction, we have to move from, I can't have that, to I don't want that. Because the truth of the matter is, you really can't have it anytime you want. You're just in a season where you got to get these numbers down before you die prematurely. Like, I need y'all to quit playing with this thing. Like, I don't understand, E, why if somebody gets diagnosed with cancer, it's all hands on deck and I'm willing to do whatever it takes to treat. But when I get diagnosed with high cholesterol, hypertension, I can spend 20 years, you know, playing around with maybe doing a little better. The number one cause of death in the U.S. is heart disease. The precursors to heart disease is hypertension, high cholesterol. Why don't we take that as serious as we take something like cancer? Because the marketing dollars haven't been put behind it to get you guys to understand the severity of these conditions. Being overweight is a pre-existing condition. It is what it is. Having excess visceral fat around your arteries is a health risk. So if you're overweight, if you're battling one of these lifestyle diseases, kidney failure, autoimmune disease, mental health issues, food affects mood just as much as it affects you from the neck down, it affects you from the neck up. So we have to take these things serious. If you're not your best self, I don't understand how you expect to execute on the things that God has assigned you to do. It doesn't make sense. You cannot be radically obedient and unwell. Pick a struggle. But if you wanna execute on an assignment that God has given you, your body and your brain, your physical, mental, and emotional health have to be optimized first.
This is just from me to you.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of just a mindset of our people and why it's so difficult.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause you mentioned it. You have cancer. So culturally,
mm-hmm.
I have an understanding of what I need to be doing.
Yep.
You see what I'm saying? And I always tell people as a speaker, the reason why I talk about what I talk about, because when you're an educator, it's easier to use a frame of reference that somebody already has than to use a new frame of reference.
Because
what it does to the brain, like, you know, I'm trying to figure out what you're saying before I even know what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
So I told Ma, I was like, yo, Ma, you're the first person ever framed it in a way where it's not just something that we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
It's not information. Like, you framed it in a way where it's a part of my life.
Yeah.
I never, like, when you said you made a vow to your college self that when you hit 30, 40, 50, 60, you're going to be the same weight. I was like, yo, Ma, I've had housing goals. I've had credit goals.
Mm-hmm.
I never made a pact with myself about where I would be physically.
Mm-hmm.
I never even thought, like, I always thought that my body was responsible for my body.
Mm-hmm.
Like you going to take care of me.
Mm-hmm.
You've always taken care of me. When I go to the hospital and they tell me my numbers, well, you've always taken care of me.
Yeah.
So, but I didn't know that wasn't the truth. I didn't know you're active. You just don't know you're active.
Yep.
It's a part of what you do. You don't know that you eat a certain way. Like, you don't know that. And what you also don't know is that you eat a certain way, but because of your age, it's just some stuff that I'm doing for you, Eric, that I won't be able to do for you.
Yes.
When you hit 50.
Yes.
So I'm going to need your help more as we get older.
Yes.
And then, Eric, there's certain things that you're eating that you're creating a habit with me that mm-hmm. once you're ready to stop, I'm not ready to stop.
Mm.
So then
yep.
when you said to me, I don't remember what gig I had, but it was, oh I do. It was the UOU. Boy, when you was like, how long is it, E? I was like, 7 days. And you were like, okay, well, don't eat sugar for 7 days. Like, you can eat it on the eighth day if that's what you choose, addict. But you need to be
clear this week.
Yeah, you need to be clear this week because you're spitting out information.
That's it.
And so I was like, okay, but what you didn't know that I didn't tell you, not because I was hiding it, But because I didn't know what was going on, I had called Sean and was like, yo, Sean, I'm not as sharp. Mm. Like, I'm not really sure what's going on with me, bro, but like, I'm forgetting stuff.
Mm.
And it's not my age. I'm like, yo, I know age. I've been in my body for a long time. This is kind of like weird. Like, I don't remember people's names unless I'm with them all the time. Mm-hmm. And I should remember her name.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this ain't a person I don't know.
Yeah.
And so when you were like, so Sean was like almost into this exploratory thing. Like, okay, give me more. Like, okay, are you doing something different? What are you doing? What are you? And I was like, okay, I don't have time.
to diagnose
I don't
this.
Have time for that, Sean. Like, I don't know. Like, Sean, you my dude. I know why you asking me.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, I don't remember stuff already. So I'm not sure I can know why I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
You feel what I'm saying? But when you said that, I was like, oh.
That's it.
Oh, sugar. And then when you start breaking down what it does, and then I'm like, oh, I'm older. So my body never could handle it.
Mm.
But when I'm younger, it could fight it more. It can't fight it like that.
Yep.
So I was like, okay, I got it.
Yep.
So then it was like, okay, let that go first. Then we talked about the stress. And then so I start like, okay, Maul, I hear what you're saying, but I can't do that without a vision. So I got to do a vision. So it's like, okay, I'm not just going to run. I'm going to run a marathon.
Mm-hmm.
Not even for the marathon. I need to be doing something on a daily basis to fight this. And then I woke up one day and was like, yo, I'm remembering stuff.
Yep. Oh.
I'm like, oh, no. I need to call Sean. I never called him back, but I was like, yo, I'm bouncing again. Like,
yes.
I'm preaching, and in real time, stuff is coming to me, and I'm saying it, and I'm seeing how they responded to it. I'm like, oh, I'm on the journey to optimal again. You know what I'm saying? But it was like, I didn't see how that was affecting this, but when I could no longer do this naturally, I was like, whoa, hold up, E. Like, you don't got a lot of skill sets, you know, and the one you have is starting to be
compromised.
Yeah, it's like, whoa, your brain and your wittiness and your quickness and your ability to recall stuff, that's your gift. So if you can't remember somebody's name, like, that's what they know you for. Like, yo, how you remember them, E? How you remember that? What made you think of that?
Yep.
So I was like, okay, we got it. So then the sugar, I started saying, okay, yep, I love you, but I gotta. And so that part that you talked about, though, was that long period of time that I went without.
Mm-hmm.
And then my daughter's birthday.
Mm.
And my wife was like, yo, we gotta have a cake. It's her birthday.
Mm.
And let me tell you, Carl, when we got the cake, Carl, when we got the cake, I was like, yo, why are you eating a cake like this? Like, you ain't never... Like, I'm not even a cake dude.
Yeah.
I'm not saying I wouldn't eat cake, but I don't have a dessert challenge.
Yeah.
To your point, all of my sugar has come from drinking.
Yeah.
That has always been my thing. A grape juice or just some juice. Like, I've always had to have some juice in my life. It's like, so if I eat a meal, it ain't complete.
And
if
I don't have a juice. Yeah.
And I ain't never really been a pop dude. I got hit with being first class and like, they keep asking me, do I want something to drink? And I did pay $1,500 for this ticket. I'm like, yeah, let me go get that. And girl, it was little. It was the little boy. Like, I never even got the can. I'm like, you can hold on to the can. I don't need that. Just give me the little tip. Give me a dime bag. I need a nickel. I don't want to seem like, I never wanted to seem like I was an addict.
I'm
just give me a dime bag.
That's it.
You know, but when I ate moderation. That cake, I was like, okay, something's wrong here. Like, You ate it until it was gone.
Mm.
And I was like, but when you said what you said in terms of, yup, you detoxed, then my body was like, all right, bruh.
Yeah.
So now that's the next part, is like the detox part has to be my goal. Like, you got to get the victory over. I don't care if you go 6 months. I don't care if you go a year. It doesn't matter. If you come back like this, even if you don't do it for another year, it shows you something about yourself.
That's right.
And so, yeah, I got to, I just was I wanted this to be a podcast. It turned out to be something else.
This stuff is no joke.
Yeah.
Yep. I'm glad you got to recognize that mental clarity because that's the number one thing that happened to me. when I got rid of all mucus causing food, the divine downloads.
Yeah.
I'd be listening back to my stuff like, you killed that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
no, for real.
Where'd that come from?
Yeah. Yeah.
It happens all the time.
Yeah.
But as soon as I done accidentally had sugar before, and I know straight away, I'm like, oh, I can't. What did we eat last? Oh, we ate out. They probably put something in the sauce.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Straight away.
Yeah.
That's how clean you want to be. And I'm like, dang, I got this speaking gig. I can't.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The mental clarity is next level. And most people are never introduced to that version of themselves.
I'm back at home.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. You can feel it.
I'm gonna just chill a little bit.
Yeah.
And exactly what he said, my mom's birthday.
Wow.
Took one little piece of cake. And I promise you.
Instant.
I'm talking about like, then I took a piece of the icing. Because at first I was like, I ain't gonna do the icing. I don't.
And that's what
sugar.
I did.
Right.
I didn't do the icing, but I did do the cake.
I did a little piece, and then the exact thing. Every other day I was getting a little slither and a little slither. But what I told myself, addict, is that once I go back, I'm gonna stop sugar.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I'm doing 6 weeks of damage. I've been barbecuing for 6 weeks.
Ooh, that's a lot
six
of damage.
Weeks.
That's and a I'm lot just of damage.
Like, you know, here. I started sipping juice. My kids got some little fruit juices. No sugar added.
Yep.
No sugar added.
That's it.
That's all fruit juices.
None of that.
None.
I'm saying over that course of time, I let myself just.
Yep. It gets its hooks in you quick. And you got to kick it again.
What is that word again?
Gets its hooks in you quick. The sugar. Like it takes over you quick. It don't take much.
In one conversation, you changed my mindset about sugar. Literally, we were on the bus going to Xcaret in Mexico. We happened to be on the same shuttle together. And in one conversation, literally, that entire trip, to my knowledge, I ate zero sugar. At Xcaret, the donuts, the milkshakes that you could get on call, I did zero. No juice, nothing. Like, literally, in a conversation,
praise
I
God.
Stopped.
Praise God.
Fix salt.
He's like, now salt.
I'm just saying, like, for real.
Because
we do, all of us are one or the other.
That's good.
And they both lead to
something.
Yeah. So salt.
Yeah, so that's a good point. So what most people do is exactly what you said. They trade one addiction for another, right? Because another belief that comes along with this is that everybody has to have a vice, right? So with salt, the thing about it is, just biologically really quick or molecularly, salt and sodium are two different things. We need sodium to live. So the issue sometimes is that people don't understand. They like, don't we need salt? I'm like, well, we need sodium. Sodium is a electrolyte. It's a mineral that comes from the soil. So we can get it naturally. Salt is a combination of sodium and chloride, NaCl. So eliminating salt from the diet is doable and possible. Abstinence, if you know is an issue, right? But the amount you want to stay under, the gift with salt is that it doesn't hijack your brain like sugar does. And it also doesn't feed tumors, cancer or non-cancer cells, disease promoting like sugar does. And also, there's not 101 versions of it like sugar is. Right? The brown rice syrup, the dextrose, the high fructose corn syrup, raw sugar, cane sugar, brown sugar, all of that. That's just different ways to process the poison. So salt can be a little safer unless you have a pre-existing condition like high blood pressure or something. And excess is always going to be a problem. So the amount you want to stay under is 1,500 milligrams or less a day for salt. The quickest way to get the bulk of it out of your diet, though, is eliminating processed and packaged foods. So what most people try and do when they got to give up salt, they're like, Lisa, I got this blood pressure. Guess what I stopped doing? What? I stopped using salt to season my food. You ain't eliminate much. I would prefer you keep seasoning your food with salt and stop ordering a pizza. Because the reason we have high blood pressure is we're getting the bulk of our salt from foods where we didn't control the dosage. When we season, we control the dosage. Teaspoon, couple teaspoons. But that's what we eliminate the least amount and we keep the bulk because we can't stop eating the fast food, the junk food, right? So if I still eat salt myself, I season my food with salt, but my diet is 80 to 90% label free. Most people's diet is 80 to 90% labels. You're eating out of a can, a box, a bag, a takeout container. Frozen. And so all of that
That's good.
Has salt added because salt is a preservative. So it extends the shelf life of all food. So part of the reason it's added to packaged food is because it can sit on the shelf until you're ready to buy it. Yeah. So if you want to get rid of salt, eliminate as much processed food as you can. Eliminate as much fast junk food. Doesn't mean you can't eat out, but you know, you when you eat out, everything is doesn't have to be salted. Like, you know, so eliminate as much fast processed food as you can. And then you can continue to season because that's where you, what you're controlling. Eliminate the stuff you're not controlling.
Yeah, and I'm telling you, what I started doing, especially when I was on the road, is I started saying, and didn't know I could say it, but I started saying,
yeah,
don't put no salt on my food.
Yep.
You feel me? Now, yep. It's going to taste different.
It is.
Yeah, it's going to taste different.
And when it gets to the table, you can salt it a little bit yourself.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
But I started just going like, hey, do me a favor.
Because they heavy with it.
Yeah, I'm like, that's broccoli. I'm good.
Yeah.
Like, you don't got to put nothing on it.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm good. Don't put nothing on it. And then I'll, the salad, don't season the salad.
Yes.
Because they'll do it in front of you, but in the back, they did it. I'm like, don't do that.
Yeah.
Just bring out the lettuce and tomato and let me do whatever. But Carl, there is a donut shop up the street. Now, listen to me, Carl. This was before, this is like Cali. So this is 4 years. I don't even know how we found out about the donut shop, but I'm going to just say this to you. Like, I don't even have a donut fetish. Like, I'm not even into donuts like that. Donuts are, of course, a part of our culture.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, if you don't want to buy nobody a cake and you got to do something quick, you get donuts. So I've been donuts. Then I'm an educator. So, you know, donuts is always in the school.
Yeah.
Always. But I'm really not a donut person like that. Bruh, when I tell you, I was like, whoa, they making these fresh. Like, these taste, like, these melt in your mouth, right? So when I, you know, Lisa was on the sugar thing. So the leg thing, the sugar thing now. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, okay, I can't eat that. Like, I'm not going by the donut place. I told Didi, like, we're not going there no more. Like, whatever your little struggle is, do that. But don't go to the donut place because that's an addiction.
Yeah.
Like, the way they make it, it's a full blown. You're going to be an addict.
Yeah.
Right? So one time I was like, man, cool thing is they close at 3. So it's like, by the time I get my day going, I wouldn't go into like 2, 3-ish, because I'm not about to go eat no donuts at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Right? So one time it was like 2 something. And I was like, okay, I gotta go to Shell. The only gas station that we have is in the same plaza as the donut. I'm like, bruh, who does that? Why is there a gas station in the plaza?
Yeah.
Like, gas stations are supposed to be
standalone,
yeah. Bruh. It's a gas station. They got that joker with everything. And I was going, and I was like, okay, Lisa. And I'm like, why is this happening to me? I'm a grown man. Why is she in my head? And why don't I feel comfortable going to get? And so I just wanted to say, another way to overcome addiction is having an accountability person.
In your head.
Yeah, in your head. Yep, to wake, right, to that point. To get in your head. So she's nowhere. I'm in Cali. She and Mitch, we ain't nowhere near each other. But I'm like, what would Lisa say? And then more importantly, how would your brain respond to this? And how scary was it to not have mental clarity? How scary was that? Bump cancer and all that.
Yeah.
It was scary because I was like, yo, you 50.
Yeah.
What's going to happen if you 70? Like, if you can't remember now with clarity, what's going to happen when you hit 70? So if you can look at that person in the camera, who are you talking to and what do they need to do right?
Yeah. So if you are in a place where you know your health is more of a liability than an asset to your life right now, the very first thing I need you to do is make up your mind that nothing else is going to become priority until you are optimized, until your physical, mental, and emotional health is at the height that it needs to be to execute on the assignment that God has given you. It's really important that when we're starting our health journey, we have a clear understanding of where we are so that we can properly track and measure where we're going. So I want to invite everybody watching and or listening to take our Optimal Health Assessment. This is a proprietary health assessment created by me to help gauge where you are in different areas of your health, not just nutrition or exercise, but also in areas like success and overall fulfillment in life. So you can visit lisaangelsmith.com/assessment to take our Optimal Health Assessment. It takes 7 minutes or less. It's roughly about 20 questions, and it'll give you a great foundational understanding of where you're starting. And at the end, you'll be invited to book a health assessment clarity call with us to get even more direction on where you should be going to really achieve optimal health. And if you need help with that, I want you to reach out to me at lisaangelsmith.com or email me at hello@lisaangelsmith. We'll book a call, we'll sit down, and we'll come up with an exit strategy from your undesirable circumstance and an enter strategy into your desirable.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
a big
this
deal.
Is, I don't know the name of this podcast. We'll come up with a name for it,
sure.
But you heard the content and you heard it in a way you've never heard it before.
Yeah.
And it hit you in a way it never hit you before. So I need you to, I need you to respond. It's your boy ET. Now you know, let's go.
If you enjoy the Secrets to Success podcast, if you're looking for more facts, fun, and foolery, you don't want to miss the next few Patreon episodes. Get ready for exclusive content, uncensored discussions, and never before heard stories. Lock into the Patreon now and go deeper into the world of E.T. the Hip Hop Preacher, Jamal King, CJ, and the Beijing Sensation. S2S Podcast, where knowledge meets entertainment.